What's up, guys? I'm Brandon Davenport, and you're watching Caffeine Nation.
Last summer, we went on a road trip through the central and western United States to educate ourselves on coffee roasting and coffee culture in America. After 5,000 miles, 24 roasters, and 100 cups of coffee, we headed straight to the source.
Santa Ana, El Salvador.
We're here to learn about every stage the coffee goes through before being exported and roasted. This is the story of Aida Batlle, the J. Hill Mill, and one of the most widely consumed beverages in the world. Meet Aida Batlle. She's a coffee rock star who was raised in Miami, spent time in Nashville, and has dedicated the last 12 years of her life to running her family's coffee farms.
Well, I'm a fifth-generation coffee producer that moved back to El Salvador November of 2002 to help my father out with the farms. I figured, you know, fifth generation, all of us lived in the U.S., it was maybe time for one of us to come and help him out. So I decided to make the move.
In 2003, only 1 year later, she entered both Finca Kilimanjaro and Finca Los Alpes into the first El Salvadorian Cup of Excellence. Out of 336 farms, they placed first and 16th.
And I was the first female producer to ever win a Cup of Excellence anywhere.
Aida has developed more finely tuned methods of harvesting and fermenting the coffee cherries, resulting in consistently amazing coffees that are highly sought after and well awarded.
So I was introduced to the J. Hill Mill and Mario in 2003 because they were the mill in charge of dry milling the Cup of Excellence slots that year.
Basically, J. Hill is a coffee producer, a miller, and exporter.
So Mario is the executive director here at J. Hill.
I oversee all the three big operations that the company is involved in.
I mean, I saw the operation they had here. I was extremely impressed. So we started working together. And then we come to find out that my great-great-grandfather, who was General Narciso Avilés, he's the gentleman that introduced the Bourbon variety to El Salvador in the late 1800s. And then the first person he shared it with was Mr. James Hill, who's the founder of J. Hill. So the Aida Batlle Selection Program here with J. Hill, or ABS as we abbreviate it, is a program we started 4 years ago. And it was basically discovering these great, wonderful coffees they had here and helping these farms and producers shine.
We wasted no time and headed straight out to familiarize ourselves with some of the first stages of the growth of a coffee plant. This is the J. Hill Mills nursery, ground zero, where the coffee seeds are planted into rich soil and closely monitored and cared for the first 6 to 8 months of their lives. For many years, the J. Hill Mill has been utilizing a special technique called grafting. We had the chance to view this firsthand when they replaced the weak root system of a flavorful Bourbon variety with the more efficient root system of the less flavorful Robusta plant. I wouldn't expect that if you attach two halves of a plant together with medical tape, that it would just mend itself together and continue to grow. But grafting is a widely used and effective method of solving this problem.
So here we have the grafting where from here down, it's Robusta, and from here up, it's Orange Bourbon.
The next step was to take a couple of 6 to 8 month old plants out to a farm and get them in the ground. So we grabbed a couple of healthy plants and headed up the slopes of a volcano to Finca Plan de la Batea. We eventually made our way to Finca Kilimanjaro, one of Aida's four family farms located on the slopes of the Santa Ana volcano.
Kilimanjaro is a farm my father bought in 1973. It is a farm that starts at 1,580 meters.
Goddamn.
And goes all the way up to 1,720 meters. It is planted with a Kenya variety and also with Bourbon. And this is the Bourbon. So you see the difference in bean size?
Oh yeah. So Bourbon versus Kenya.
Yep.
Eat these?
Sure. You want to spit the seeds out? Okay. And the skin.
Yum. It's actually really, really delicious.
Hola.
Getting out in the bushes and picking some cherries was the one thing that I was looking forward to the most out of this whole trip. So I was stoked to strap on a basket and get to work.
You're looking for blood red, burgundy red.
Y deja los verdes.
Sí. Yes.
Para más tiempo. Y después.
Más tiempo se corta.
Vale.
Al mes, ¿sabes? 40 días.
So I consider myself extremely privileged at the moment. This is a really exciting thing for me to do. There were about 20 people in the bushes with me picking only the ripest cherries. This was one of the final passes through these particular plants. Traditionally, most farmers send their pickers in to clear out the cherries in bulk, whereas Aida sends her teams in to make several passes through the plants, ensuring that only the ripest cherries are picked in each batch to limit post-pick sorting. At the end of the day, we gathered up all of our cherries and sorted again, removing any over or under-ripened cherries and any cherries showing signs of Broca, a small bug that makes its home inside of the coffee bean, hollowing it out and stripping its core contents.
And I want you guys to see what an excellent, tremendous job she has done.
Wow.
Out in the field.
The consistency is incredible.
The consistency is incredible. You will still see some unripes and greens that are in there, but for the most part, it would not take her that long to sort through that.
From there, each person's batch is weighed and their wages are calculated according to how much they picked. The cherries are then condensed into 150-pound sacks and loaded onto a truck. There's some guys not much larger than myself loading these sacks onto the truck, so I thought I'd give it a go.
Pesa poco.
No.
After almost biting the dust, I realized that these guys were tough as nails. We then headed back down the mountain to the J. Hill Mill.
Granos rojos.
We began the wet milling process at the smaller of the two wet mills. This one is used particularly for small batches, be it experimental methods of fermentation or limited runs. The machine works like this. You begin by dumping all of your coffee cherries into these containers. Cherries are then pumped through these tubes to a large siphon of water where they're floated by weight. Any cherries that float are removed in order to keep consistent quality. The healthy and ripe coffee cherries sink to the bottom and continue flowing through canals to the next stage. The higher density cherries that make the cut then go through a mechanical depulper where the coffee beans are squeezed out of the cherry and the pulp is thrown into a pile outside the machine. There's all kinds of interesting stuff that goes on with the coffee pulp that we'll go into later. After depulping, the beans are shook around and rinsed. They're sent into several different fermentation tanks to undergo different processes. This round, she's doing Kenya, Ethiopia, and Burundi.
Basically, fermentation is what it goes on. It's a chemical process. At the beginning, all the slime that you feel, the mucilage, which is very slippery at the beginning, after fermentation, it becomes solid.
We then visited the larger wet mill, which operates in essentially the same way, but on a much larger scale.
So, with me in the shot, you can really see how massive these things are.
The process ends with the depulped coffee beans making their way through these channels to large fermentation tanks. After fermentation, the beans are laid across large drying patios to sit for several days. Higher quality or ABS coffees are hand raked, whereas the more generic coffees are raked by a tractor. Having the opportunity to taste a coffee cherry was an extremely enlightening experience for me.
First coffee cherry.
Brought to mind all these subtle acidic flavors from lighter roasted coffees that I've certainly become familiar with, but haven't been able to identify the source of.
Coffee bean.
Another coffee bean.
Sweet, subtle, slightly sour, but good.
With that said, I began leaning on that flavor. I asked Aida to help me develop a coffee that, regardless of the roast, could retain the most complexities from the flavors produced by the cherry itself. And she suggested that we naturally process our beans.
Legitimately thrilling, for me at least.
You ask me, the natural process is the OG method of processing. My cherries were placed upon a mesh screen drying bed where they can get air flowing from above as well as below. They're left there to dry with all layers intact, giving each cherry its own closed environment to naturally dry. And the fruit dries onto the parchment that surrounds the coffee seeds, and the coffee beans are left inside the cherry pods before being hulled and prepared for shipment. When the coffee is finished drying, it moves to the resting stage, where we met Wilson, the production manager here at the J. Hill Mill.
This is all parchment coffee.
Here, the beans are separated into 150-pound sacks and loaded into the parchment warehouse to rest anywhere from 15 to 90 days.
And this is the parchment. This is basically the stopping point between wet milling and dry milling.
Coffee beans drop onto these screens that constantly jolt back and forth, causing the more dense coffee beans to collect on one side and the less dense on another. This is one of the several ways that the coffee beans are sorted through before being prepared for export.
Last part of the process? Yes. You see, if the copper say that the coffee and the quality is good, this is ready to go. Then you are ready to go to give some glasses of coffee. When you are drinking a cup of coffee, you have to make a ceremony. Yes, you know, the process is big.
How many hands have touched it before my cup?
So many.
And you guys are truly, truly hard workers, very friendly people here, but very, very strong and hard workers here.
Yes, it's a beautiful process. Yes.
It was a pleasure for me to come down here and meet you guys.
I feel it's important to highlight the J. Hill Mill's efforts in becoming fully self-sustaining. We learned that Aida is experimenting with making teas using the coffee cherry's pulp. That same constant accumulation of pulp is what fuels the on-site California Redworm Farm, which is what generates all of the rich compost that's used to plant the coffee seeds.
Inicialmente, cuando hablamos de comida, lo que ellas digieren es, del 100% que ellas digieren, el 60% es compost. Lo demás es un alimento para ellas.
This here is just a beautiful process where they're taking what some people would think is garbage, the cherry from the coffee, and they're feeding it to these worms who then break it down into compost, and it goes right back to fertilize new coffee plants.
Another potential destination for the coffee pulp is the ongoing 15-year experimentation of building a machine that burns the pulp and converts the emissions into carbon monoxide. They've recently fine-tuned the machine and an engine to function in unison, but the goal is for it soon to be powering the small and the large wet mill, which would massively cut power costs and contribute to waste management, as well as take the J. Hill Mill a great leap forward in self-sustainability. On top of that, they've installed an extremely extensive on-site water treatment facility that allows them to treat and reuse the water from the large and the small wet mill in order to irrigate the California Redworm Farm.
Really, really amazing to see the level of dedication and meticulousness that these people have and the amount of passion that they have for their job. It's made me really, really gain a lot of appreciation for the coffee that I have been drinking for the last few years and the coffee that I will be drinking in the next few. Having gone to the source and tasted a coffee cherry has changed the way that I will forever taste coffee brewed, because the cherry itself is an entirely different flavor than most cups of coffee you'd have. To be able to find that flavor again in a cup of coffee will take me back to El Salvador, and I can't wait for that. All right, so it's been a couple of months since we sourced our coffee in El Salvador. We're back here in LA at Stumptown's Roastery. We're about to get our coffee roasted up. Can't wait.
Rouge Smooth.